Corinthians chapter 3 verse 1 is showing you the degenerated state of humanity. When man comes to this type of characteristics and left the divine nature and is not in the basic constitution, they're not in their mankind's natural and original condition, they're not in the creative inner force anymore, they're not in the disposition and the temperament, they're not in the kind and class and essential nature and characteristics of the kingdom, they left that. They departed from the faith, and what is showing you right here now, this is the end stage of the disease and the degeneration of mankind, 2 Timothy chapter 3. This is the dissolution of societies. This is when a society is totally fallen. These are the spirits that govern mankind. This is the conduct and the behavior of the end of a society. This is the spirits that ended Rome. These are the spirits that ended the Israelite community. This is the spirit that ended the tribe of Judah and the monarchy. These are the spirits that men fall into and embrace that brings a society into total ruin. Here it is. For men shall be lovers of their own selves. What does that mean? Megalomaniac. They're seeking power. Why are they seeking power? They're seeking power because they see what's happening and they are so fearful that they want to be in control at any cost. So they're seeking power so that they don't have to be tyrannized or oppressed by anybody else. That's why they're seeking power. Their mind is off of the faith of Christ, so they're seeking power. They're power hungry. They got to be in control. I got to be in the leadership. People got to listen to me because they're afraid. So when men are lovers of themselves, that's the end stage of the iniquity abounding. The love of many has waxed cold. So they don't care about nobody else. They only care about themselves. And that doesn't mean they won't give money to you or they might not support you. But they're supporting you in order to hook you emotionally and mentally to get more from you in the end. You're just a mark. They're just going to despitefully use you. They're using something called love bombing. They'll bomb you and show all kind of kindness to you, and you think that they're into you. It's the same type of exploitation that pimps use on women that they try to turn out and abuse their virtue. It's all demonic. They're lovers of themselves, but in order for them to gain people, what they do, they feign to be a sheep, they feign to be a victim, they feign to have dealt with the same trauma, they deal with trauma bonding, they act like they're sharing the same story with you, and we went through the same thing, and we all together, but as you see time go by, they do less and less and less and less and less and less, and you're doing more and more and more and more, and you're giving more and more and more and more, and they're being meaner and meaner and meaner and meaner and less kind because the iniquity abounded and the love waxed cold. So therefore the conversation is cold. Yeah. Therefore the temperament is cold. The tone is cold. At another time we'll deal with some other part in the other books that shows what it does. When they said they use a hard and hateful language towards friends. When the iniquity of the Egyptians abounded, their conversation towards Israel waxed cold. Because as they increase in iniquity, they become meaner with people that's not part of what they're doing. But if you was of the world would love its own. But the world have hated you because Christ has chose you out of the world. So they think it evil that you don't run with them to the same excess of rioting. So if you agree with what they're doing, they'll cheer you on. But if you got to reprove them gently, if you got to rebuke them, if you got to tell them stop, what they going to do? They're going to be in the primal rage. They're going to be out to get you. They're going to try to destroy your reputation because you're interfering with their pleasure. You're interfering with the only thing they have left that's satisfying them because they're not in the love of many. They're in the lover of themselves. After what? Many broken relationships, many broken friendships, many errors, many mistakes, personal and private. Now man feels like he's a failure, so now I want everything for myself. I'm tired of caring about people. It's for me and mine, me and my family. I'm for self. That's a dead man right there. That's a man that's waiting to be destroyed. That's a man that has denied the faith. He not by love serving one another no more. He's only dealing with people to serve himself. He's not in charity. When charity seeketh not her own, it's not puffed up. Charity vaunteth not itself. It's kind. No, not dealing with that. No. Men shall be lovers of their own selves. So when you see, how you see that? See it in resources. People get monies, and they're only dealing with themselves. 10 cars, 20 cars. 10 houses. 10 jackets. But their friend, somebody that calls them a friend, got one jacket. That need to be thrown away. They got 10 boots costing hundreds of dollars. And their friend, somebody that's calling them a friend, don't have a Metro card, but they buying new boots. See, how could you do that? How could you be so cold? No, he's a love of himself. The sin is about to finish him. It's a final stage. End stage. This is terminally ill, malignant. This is when the sin is malignant. It says, men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous. What does it mean, covetous? Meaning everything you have belongs to me. You got your confidence from me. How could a man be so confused and so deceived in his mind to say something like that? And confidence is something. Christ said, hold fast the beginning of our confidence, steadfast to the end. Your confidence comes from Christ. And when I came out of Israel, I said, Lord, I want to be confident. Because I was a stand-up brother in Israel. Yeah, I would correct you if you were wrong. You better believe it. You couldn't pull no rank. And when one of the seven, I'm going to tell you how vile they were to let you know. I had my wife, was coming to the class. Very attractive. And he stepped to me and said, man, you can't have that woman. I said, who are you talking to? One of the seven did this. I said, who are you talking to? I said, you're not talking to me. I said, this is my wife. He said, no, you're not supposed to have the women. They got to be 6 months in. So he was moving with a force to back up to this, take her. I said, you can't have her. I said, this is my wife. I brought her here. And I'm not dealing with none of that. I don't care what you're saying. And he looked at me and had to step. Because he wasn't pulling that rank stuff on me, man, and there. Because what they were doing, they were covetous. They'll see you with something beautiful, but they want it for themselves. They'll see you with something wealthy or something nice or something good, they want it for themselves. This is a spirit that men want everything for themselves. Because when the sin is finished in you, you ain't no brother no more, man. It's all about you. And I wish that a lot of brothers would have stood up like that. But they didn't get her because I didn't bring her back to the school. But some men brought their women back to the school and they got taken into secret councils. And they commanded the women to leave their husbands. Why are you mentioning this, Chaarawtazar? Because I'm showing you how far covetousness goes. They'll see that it's yours. God gave it to you. And they say, you're not mature enough. That ain't you for you to decide. You shouldn't have something that beautiful. That ain't for you to decide. You sound like Ahab and Jezebel taking somebody else's field. Because Satan breaks down families and brotherhoods by making someone in leadership to be covetous. Because to really be covetous, you got to be in a position of authority to enforce the covetousness. You got to have your goons. So they had their goons. So I didn't bring her back there. Done. Mm-mm. And when she came, like, you can't talk to her. Nope, don't talk to her. And some men didn't understand the temperature. They didn't understand about covetousness, but I saw that. Because they were covetous. Some men saw other brothers had skills. And I'm going to say this about in the gospel. Some men, by the grace of the Lord Jesus, everything the Lord shares me is a gift of grace. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights. With whom there's no variableness, no shadow of turning. I acknowledge that my learning in this gospel, my ability to explain scripture, my recollection, my understanding, my interpretation means to make the interpretation means to make it plain. Interpretation means explanation, where you're bringing out the meaning. That ability is a gift of God. I acknowledge that. And I come forward to share it with other people because I see how it was a benefit to me. And some men look at the classes that I'm in and steal the content and act towards me in a way of enmity. Why, brother? Why do you do that? Why do you feel you're stealing something that's being shared with you? Why? Because you're not out of the reprobate mind. You're not out of the old man. You don't understand about sharing. That knowledge is not for vaunting. Knowledge is for the betterment and for the healing of our nation. It's for the cultivation of our people. And if you receive the benefit or blessing from a brother, why can't you mention him? Why you gotta pretend? Why you gotta set at naught the work of Christ? It's not even the brother you're setting at naught. You're setting at naught the work of Christ that was done in him for your benefit. So you're going to eat the food and slap the waiter. Because you're trying to discourage him, because you're really being covetous and you're working for the devil. Because you should be thankful. Oh, are we those kind of people? I'm going to show you something the Gentiles do. When they take somebody else's content, or use somebody to study, go look in their description. They name the people. They show what books they got it from. They mention them by name. Or you'll see on their YouTube, they'll do an interview with so-and-so. I've always admired you because of the research you've done, the in-depth, and I want to ask some questions on the air so my viewers can know you. They introduce people that they learn from to their viewers. Why can't we be like that? And we're supposed to have the highest basic constitution. We're supposed to be the first fruits of mankind's natural condition. We're supposed to operate in the creative inner force. Our mind is not supposed to be determined by anything outside of our natural being, our inherent characteristics. Why can't we salute one another? So some people will salute you in physically, say shalom or grace and peace, but they won't salute your knowledge to take your content. They'll steal your intellectual property. I've seen it over and over. And the end result of that is you don't end up growing. Because we got to love each other. Why can't we love each other? God loved all of us. Whoever hear first, whoever speaks first, or who don't speak, who says amen, God loves us. And I salute to all you brothers and sisters, man, that called me while I was in the persecution to my purpose. It's a brother Chaarawtazar. Where's the classes? Brother Chaarawtazar. Come on, man, we waiting. Brother Chaarawtazar, man, continue in the faith. Your friends are known in your adversity. Yeah, you know them. Because David thought that Ahithophel was his friend, but when David sinned, you found out that Ahithophel was not a true friend. So ain't nobody shocking me, man. 25 years I'm operating in the gospel, man. You brothers are not shocking me. When this all come out, you're going to be ashamed. So we might as well reconcile so it can be a happy ending. Because y'all know me, if I'm asked, I ain't covering it. All right, let's move on. Okay. 2 Timothy chapter 3, the end stage of the malignant behavior of the sins increase. The sins increased because man wanted to do it their way. And they thought doing it their way would benefit them. So what happened? They became lovers of themselves. And then what's the next disease? You covetous. Whatever you see somebody with, you want to take it. You want to take their friends. Look at this stuff on Facebook. People that see you with friends, and they'll friend your friends on Facebook, and then inbox your friends in order to gossip against you to take your friends. Where you think you going, man? Because you don't have no friends in real life. You got friends on Facebook. But people who know you personally avoid you at all costs. Don't you think they're going to find you out? Come on, man. Let the old man perish. Live the new creature. Make new friends. But people try to take other people's friends? What is that? This is the Gentile stuff. It says, boasters. Why are they boasting? I did this and I did that. That is a lie. Anything that was done in the gospel was done by the grace of Christ. Anything that was done by the gospel, they were supporting actors. Yes. Supporting actors. And I'm going to drop this right now before I get into the next video. Blaze Judah. That was brought online on YouTube in 2009. This was not mentioned. The instrumental person in getting online, Blaze Judah, was Idiotta from SOT. That brother. He came to me and Brother Lahab up in Mount Vernon with Rakam Moff that was there and said, you brothers, the message I was hearing you on cassette tape, y'all need to be on YouTube. So bless you, brother, and your family and your life and all you do. Because he saw it. We wasn't dealing with that. That publication area. Him. His care and concern for his people started the whole YouTube. God used him. Jesus Christ used Idiotta in 2009. So the 238 videos and the 200 videos, that brother, him. And his work is remembered with the Lord. I'm going to stop all these unmentioned stuff on my channel. I'm going to put an end to it. I'm going to make another mention. Two more mentions real quick. Maybe three more. When we were doing the cassette tapes in the 1990s, yesterday I was listening to a class about the entire book of Galatians on cassette tape, where I was teaching the class and Brother Lahab was listening and giving small input, because that's how we used to do. Whoever taught the class, the other person listening gave small input, because it was about us showing what we learned, not this new stuff. So we were giving our cassette tapes back then, and I used to be up all night. This is from the early 90s, like 96, giving our cassette tapes, sharing the learning. And Brother Paul in North Carolina used to get cassette tapes. I used to ship it out to UPS. We used to ship it out by the boxes. The Lord programmed me where I could be sleeping and I hear the tape click and I get up and turn it over. Or put a new tape in when I was able to afford one that automatically reversed. And why I'm mentioning that is this, because you got to mention certain brothers, man, that labored in this truth, man. That was instrumental. They helped it get as far as you brothers and sisters. And Brother Paul, I spoke to him about the situation being up. And this brother, back then in the 90s, bought a duplicator for $1,000 of his own money. And with that duplicator, I was able to put one tape in there, a 90-minute tape, and it duplicated three tapes in a minute and a half. And that's how it was going out. That Brother Paul. Brother Beloved left Pennsylvania, Pittsburgh to aid in the ministry for years. Left his job, his young son, he was going back. He came and lived here to aid in the ministry. Brother Beloved. These brothers was instrumental in moving it forward before the brothers that came in 2016 and 2017. This is talking about years, man, ago. And Brother Beloved was around since 1994. I met him in 92, him and Brother Paul. These brothers were instrumental forces that they got to be mentioned, man. Ain't no tomb to no unknown soldiers here, not with Christ. So they aided because they were in the love. And although we're in a final age, we could live in the ancient spirit, the old paths of virtue and righteousness. For men shall be lovers of themselves, covetous, boasters, meaning they boasted about what they did, so they leave other people unmentioned. But David said this. Check the king. Can we talk about the king's boast? The king said, in God we boast all the day long, and praise thy name forever. See, the boast must be in God. The boast must be in Jesus Christ. The boast must be in what they did through us, because we ain't nothing, man. We just flesh and blood. We didn't have to be the election of grace. It's by Him, and through Him are all things. So you can't boast to try to elevate yourself, because the end of the world is a lot of idols and man-pleasing and looking up to people. It says, boasters, proud, arrogant, and I'm better than you, and we're first, and we're superior. There's some disciples here, and some disciples down there. That is an absolute lie. Because you've shown something first, that does not make you up here and one down there. Christ said, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them to the end. Christ said, I'm going to show you that the Father loved you like he loved me. Christ said, heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ. Christ said, as the Father have loved me, so have I loved you. Who's putting degrees to diminish it to try to establish satanic superiority? Who's doing that? Because that ain't part of the gospel. All the disciples were loved. Yeah. And love in God demands responsibility. That's what people don't teach you. When you love and privileged to office, you only privileged to service. You're not privileged to be ministered unto. You privileged to minister. Your life is over when God tell you he loved you. Christ had to lay down his life because God loved him. Full service. Because the reward is also for you in the next world. Your whole life is not sitting down and people serving you. That is a lie. When you love, your whole life is service. Go check the apostles. Go check Paul. Go check the prophets. They were loved and their life was service. Their life was not entitlement. You don't know the love of God if you're talking like that. People got people carrying their briefcases and all that kind of nonsense. Mm-mm. Now let's read. Boasters, this will be blasphemous. Why? They're irreverent to God because they want to be seen. And they live after their own standard. Christ said we're supposed to adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior. To live the doctrine of God, you have to walk in the divine nature, in the fruits of the Spirit, in the holiness, in the sanctification. And the scripture said they're disobedient to parents. And God warned Israel, he said the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, as it is written. I mean, because you're saying one thing and you're living contrary to your declared beliefs. So that people don't have respect for the Father because of the naughty children. So shouldn't we stop that? We should be good children now. It said, what did it tell you? In 1 Peter, it tells us here, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 14, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to your former lusts and your ignorance, but as he that hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. And if ye call on the Father, who without respect of persons judgeth every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. Meaning, be well behaved. That's what he said. That's how you pass your time. Be well behaved. It's going to tell you, and it tells you about the well-behaved. It said you can't live the fulfilling the lusts of your flesh and of your mind. You can't deal with abominable idolatries. You can't deal with reveling in wild parties. You don't even know. We don't talk about that standard they set up, man, from one west another time. But, man, they threw so many people off. And why I'm mentioning it, because the attitude and that behavior is kept by men that came out of those schools because they don't understand about the deviant, diabolical, sinister, poisoning, venomous nature that they were affected by. People scared to talk about it. They're so scared of Arians, and scared of Marshawn, and scared of the Seven, and scared. You can't reprove them. They already reproved. It's written they reproved. Just read what the word says. It says unthankful, unholy. So why is unthankful? How could a man tell me who cares about your works? That God gonna say, I never knew you. And I put 25 years into this gospel. What kind of man would say something like that? You're not in a sound mind. Because God tell you, if a righteous man turneth away from his righteousness, he tells you what's gonna happen. None of his works shall be mentioned unto him. But I thank the Father in Christ, ain't nothing gonna turn me away from the righteousness of God. Nothing. So my reward is with him. God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love which you showed towards his name, and that you ministered to the needs of the saints. I was ministering to the needs of the saints, not a man. We were supposed to be by love serving one another, but I was here for my people. And God ain't unrighteous to forget. But it shows you that men will forget what you do for them, because also a lover of himself, he discards people when he sees it suitable. He'll just discard you. Why? Because you don't have the natural. It tells you, saints, without natural affection. Unthankful, unholy, meaning unthankful, unloving, and then it tells you without natural affection. It's showing you the disease. So if you want to know what the narcissistic traits is, everybody talks about narcissism is a plague, it's an epidemic, it's a pandemic, it transcends in countries and continents and cultures and languages. Christ already talked to you about this. It is written. It is written. People talk about revelation. 2 Timothy chapter 3 is a revelation. This is narcissism in the Bible. That's why I tell you, without natural affection, truth breakers. They'll say peace to you, but their peace is only manipulation. But I'm just calling you in peace. I'm calling you to make peace with you. But there's a plot going on. Because man don't understand there's a vibration that's here. That it, like, this is a sodomite you see. You gotta have one, Christ. And you get swimming in the water. You gotta have on your scuba diving suit. So that water don't get in your system, and have on your mask, and your oxygen is so toxic out here. God said, except the Lord would have left us a seed, we'd have all been like Sodom, even unto Gomorrah. That's how bad the current here is. The vibration, the stimuli, the impulses. Boys 12 years old telling their parents that I want to be called she. Can you believe it? Look at the current. Look at the vibration. Meaning, look at the gaslighting, the altering of the mental disposition of the minds. That's why you need to establish the word in your house. That's why you need to have a basic constitution. To shut down the stimuli, to shut down the lust of the flesh, because the knowledge of Christ and the knowledge of the Son of God is a spirit. And that spirit repels the satanic spirit. That's a fact. It says false accusers, showing you the narcissistic megalomaniac spirit, the love of himself spirit, it operates in false accusations. Why? Because the false accusation is to try to crush, is to try to break anyone that does not submit to their power and their control. That's why they use false accusation, to try to bring you or punish you for not obeying their rulership or their power. Or doing what they say, not being under their control. That's why they use. That's why it says false accusers here. It's a power trip. False accusers all bullying. They're bullying. People who persecute people are all bullies. They're trying to bully you. Then it says incontinent. They got to get it out. That's why their mouth is so vicious. You know, in my anger. And I had my anger. No, brother, you incontinent. No, sister, you incontinent. Fierce, showing you. And people think that fierce spirit, that fiery spirit, I'm a fire spirit, you need to check your spirit. Because if you're not Christ's spirit, you're none of his. If any man hath not the spirit of Christ, he's none of his. So don't tell me you're a fire spirit, and you're a water spirit, and you're an air spirit. Don't tell me if you don't have Christ's spirit, Christ said you're none of his. You got to deal with his character, his conduct, and guess what? Walk in his spirit or you're none of his. I don't know you. But Satan will deceive you to symbiotically justify his control over your mind and actions and character. Yeah, you fierce and you tough and you rugged and you bold. And people think somebody's bold, or he's a rough brother, he's bold and he's a stand-up person. But he's really impudent. Because impudence is cocky boldness that is in disregard of the moral principles and the doctrines of life. So people are calling people bold. A harlot is bold. But her boldness is really impudence. That she don't fear. That's why she operates the way she operates. And misuses her body. And destroys marriages. She's impudent. She ain't bold. So some men, people think in their evil, in their meanness, that they both know they're impudent. They're stiff-necked. You have to understand the mental, psychological, parasitic control that's over their mind, how they deceive into thinking their weakness is strength. They speak their mind. No, they setting on fire the course of hell. They ain't speaking their mind. They're speaking Satan's mind. They're speaking venom. Their mouth is full of cursing and bitterness, the way of peace they have not known. Destruction and misery are in their ways. That's why they have no friends. That's why they have no family. So they try to take other people's friends because their mouth has destroyed everything around them. And they're constantly regrouping in life. That's what's happening. Because their mouth has destroyed everything around them. Because God said, if any man bridle not his tongue, his religion is vain. Because he was a forgetful hearer, then he was not blessed in his deed. So he's envious about a person that was blessed in their deed. But saints, we all blessed. Why don't we obey the conduct that manifests the blessing? If we all blessed in Christ, why don't we obey the conduct that makes the blessing manifest? Since Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law. God said your iniquities are withholding these good things from you. So bad behavior gonna hide your blessing from you. Good behavior gonna make it manifest. Alright. False accusers, constant and fierce, despisers of those that are good. So if you don't join them, these lovers of themselves, and tell me how great I am. Tell me how great my speech is. Tell me how great I look. Endless praise. Fandom. Tell me I'm right when I'm wrong. Don't tell me I'm going off in the scripture. Don't tell me to... Just praise me endlessly. Whoever does not do that, they're going to be despised. That's what Christ said. Woe unto you when men shall speak well of you, for such that they are the false prophets. Because if you correct our people, you're going to be despised. Because you're messing up their high. You're messing up their fix. Some people have flattery as a fix. Some people have lies as a fix. Some people have praise as a fix. And if they hear too much about Christ, their corruption is so high and untreated that hearing too much about Christ, they become irritated. You got to talk about me. I want to say something. That's the level of immaturity and the lack of development that's going on. The Christ said, I came to heal the world. The physician came not to call the righteous to repentance, but to save sinners, to heal the sick. Despisers of those that are good. So if you don't join them, if you don't join their praise, if you're not in the adoration of them, if you see them as a mortal, which they are, if you see them as a man, which they are, if you see them as a brother, which they are, if you're not in a grandiose delusion of their false power, then they despise you. They'll say, you envy me. No, I don't. Why? And a lot of brothers that use the scripture, it said, Ephraim shall not envy Judah. But what are you talking about, man? You talking about somebody envy you because you Judah? You don't know what you're talking about. People that's in Christ is risen from those spirits, man. When you rich, when you loved, you're not bound by those spirits. You're free. You got to understand the freedom that's in Christ. Whom the Son shall set free is free indeed. You are free from those feelings that other people are bound in the flesh. You ain't got to envy nobody when all things are yours. Saints, in our mind, let's take a look at something. Christ said, I became poor that you might be made rich. Think rich. We together, we all thinking rich. Christ said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ. We talking rich. Christ said, now abideth faith. We talking faith. Now abideth hope. We talking hope. Now abideth charity. We talking charity. How does envy get in there? And it's a charity envy if not. Can't get in there. It's a different atmosphere. So Ephesians tells you, he raised us up and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ. We're not even dealing with that atmosphere. So if you feel that fiery dart, elevate your plane. Elevate the plane of your mind. Elevate your thoughts. So you're sitting down rich, knowing all things are yours. You're sitting down with the promises. You sitting down knowing that God got a name, a stone with your name written in it. That Christ gonna name, write the name of God in your forehead and his name in your forehead. You're gonna sit with Christ in his throne. You are heir of God, joint heir with Christ. God that worketh in you to will and to do of his good pleasure. One man planteth, another man watereth, God giving the increase. You were made for the habitation of God by the Spirit. If you know all those things, look at the elevation of your mind. You're not in the depressed feelings, influences, sensations of envy, strife, bickering. You're too locked into what's happening. You're too locked into the operation of faith. You're dealing with too much power in Christ to deal with the prince of the power of the air. You're driven. You're persevering. As I said, brother, be of one mind. Live in peace, and the God of love and peace shall be with you, and the peace of God that passeth all understanding. They say, well, you got to envy me. You got to envy me. You don't understand. The peace of God passes all understanding. The love of Christ constraineth me. The love of Christ is a compelling force. It keeps you from that behavior. And if somebody shoots you with a fiery dart, it deactivates the bug. It deactivates the stinger. Because some people need to be envied to feel good. They want to come around you and act like they're better than you because that's the only way they feel good. But if you're not moved by that, as it said, Elisha was not moved at the presence of any prince, neither could any word overcome him, then they're going to be despisers of them that are good. Then they're going to be a traitor to you. See, you seeing it right now? They're reacting. They're reacting to you that's in the spirit. They're showing you in this season, they're going to despise those that are good. Because why? They want to be the center of attention. This is a mental degenerative state. This is an unsound mind. Christ said, I'm not giving you the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. But this is an unsound, reprobate mind right here. Because if you don't retain God in your knowledge and be lowly and meek, this is the chemistry, the biological and psychological makeup. Your cells and your stomach are going to be reacting to these spirits. It says traitors heady. And heady means intoxicating. So there'll be a traitor to you in the brotherhood. There'll be brothers with you today and done. They ain't a brother to you again. As I said, friends shall suddenly fight one another like enemies. Why did that happen? Because there was a grudge that was never treated. There was unforgiveness that was never treated. There was pride that was growing. There was conceit that was growing. There was hurt that was from childhood that was growing that they wanted to take out on you. And since it was growing untreated, now it's malignant. Heady. So when they're traitors, what they do, they're heady. Meaning, they're intoxicating. Your speech intoxicates other people. Where other people are drunken by the charismatic words and brought into the traitorous behavior. Where said the love of many wax cold in them. They're turning people into icebergs. It happened in the fall of Jerusalem. What is it? He that killeth you shall think he doeth God's service. Traitors. They betray you in the time of need. They're a traitor. Well, they're a traitor to love. They're a traitor to truth. They're a traitor to the covenant. They're a traitor to the doctrine. They're a traitor to the obedience of Christ. Because well, remember, it begins that they were love of themselves. So since they're love of themselves, they ain't faithful to nobody but themselves. Then it says here, high-minded. Even if you show them the word, they toss the scripture away. I don't want to hear them scriptures. Don't show me that word. Nobody can correct me. They elevated where they think there's another book, another principle, that their words are more important than what Christ said. The high-mindedness is this, that they feel that their speech is more important than the word of the gospel of Christ. High-minded. The people should listen to them more than to hear what Christ said. Hear their opinion, hear their philosophy. That's why I said, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and through vain deceit after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. So the philosophy is what intoxicates people. They're trying to show you another way to live because they're trying to make you, trying to become your father. And they want you to carry their doctrine and carry their feeling and carry their personality in the world because they failed in their own family. They failed in their own recruiting. Nobody else ain't bite that. Like on the street in the gang world. They take other people's children and make their children their sons to carry their vice into the world. It's the same venomous behavior. It's that lovers of pleasures, more than lovers of God, hear what it says, having a form of godliness, meaning in the Bible. They have a form of godliness, meaning they're wolves in sheep's clothing, meaning they appear to be brothers. They appear to be, people think they're godly people. They have a form of godliness, meaning they're holding the form of God. They have the form of godliness. They have the Bible, but hear what it says, but denying the power thereof. How did they deny the power thereof? They did not change. They were whisperers. They were backbiters. They were lovers of themselves. They were covetous. They were boasters. They were proud. They were blasphemers. They were disobedient to parents. They were unholy. They were without natural affection. And people say, with the lovers of themselves, the narcissists say that they do not have the ability to feel affection for other people. They just pretend to feel connected. But the damage has been done to them mentally. They don't feel the connection with people. They even look up Asperger's syndrome online because they feel like they're an alien, although they're in a group with other people. But the reason why a lot of people think they have Asperger's syndrome, because you don't understand what pride does to you. Pride isolates you from other people because you feel you're so elevated. You feel you're so better. You feel you're so superior. The helium cuts you off from the integral connection with other people. Because of where your mind is at. That's why it's called a mental illness. It said, so when it says having the form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away, because they had the word, but they did not let the word work effectually in them to convert them and change them. They never became a new creature. They held the Bible, but they were really lovers of themselves. They want people to adopt their words, adopt their principles, adopt their attitude, adopt their behavior, because they were more in love with themselves. They always turn the conversation back to themselves and what they did. The form of God, but denying the power. What is the power they denying? The power to change. The power of holiness. Because Christ said he chastened us that we might be partakers of holiness. They never came into the holiness. And it tells you here, from such turn away, don't have nothing to do with them. Because they're pretending. And hear what it said they're going to do. For of this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women, laden with sins. So they're leading captive silly women laden with sins. They're also leading captive silly men. Because they need sycophants. They need yes men. They need people that's not going to hold them accountable. This is a spirit that's operating now, that people call it narcissism. And it says here, silly women laden with sins, led away with diverse lusts. Why are they with women with diverse lusts? Because they too themselves are living in diverse lusts. So the women are not, they're not going to tell the women to be disciplined. Why? Because the men themselves are not disciplined. They're not going to teach sanctification and holiness because the men themselves are not dealing with sanctification and holiness. Remember, they're lovers of pleasures more than lovers of God. Ever learning and never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now as Jannes and Jambres withstood Moses, even so do these resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds reprobate concerning the faith. Look at what it's saying here. As Janies and Jambies withstood Moses' witchcraft and sorcery, showing you this whole thing you read in 2 Timothy chapter 3 is people that have been bewitched. And they withstood Moses. They resist the power to change. It's time for us to change. So do these resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. We began in Romans 1 about the reprobate behavior. And then it says here, but they shall proceed no further, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men, as theirs also was. So they're going to be revealed. Meaning the pretenders are going to get exposed. That's it. So God has given everybody a chance. Be clean, man. Be holy. Be upright. Be just. Be pure. Now, we have to look at that, saints. Oh, we looked at that. That's beautiful, right? Okay. Some of you may want to take a break for a moment and reflect on these things. Because God wants us to see when Christ Jesus said, whom the Son set free is free indeed, are you free? Are you free from the low self-esteem? Are you free from the worry? Are you free from the fears? Because people that are fearful, they're also depressed. And people that are depressed are always angry. See, a sign of anger. The person's always angry because they're afraid. They're depressed. They're in low spirits. There's unresolved issues in their life. But if they will know the truth about God's love, then they will be made free. Saints, take a minute. Look at your loved ones. Share with them the love of God. The love of the Father, the hope of the new heaven and the new earth. Be merciful to the fatherless and to the widows. Remind people about the love of God. And but first, speak to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Comfort your own soul and remove sorrow from your heart, for sorrow hath killed many. And since sorrow hath killed many, some people are walking around, they killed in themselves. That's why they're so bitter, because in themselves they feel killed. But I beseech you by the grace of God and by the love of Christ, be risen with Christ this day. Be strengthened in Christ Jesus this day. Be revived in Christ Jesus this day. Be blessed in Christ Jesus this day. Be enlarged in Christ Jesus this day. Be increased in Christ Jesus this day. Be multiplied in Christ Jesus this day. Because he that called you is holy. God is in love with you. Can you take that into your heart? Can you believe that as your truth? Can you let him be your guide? Will you obey him unto your salvation so he can give you the Holy Spirit and guide you and comfort you? I leave that question with you, my brothers and sisters. In the love of God, in the peace of Christ, I tell you grace and peace.